you very much, Amit. Thank you, Anirban. It's wonderful that you have organized a conference like this. It does stress the importance of continuing discussion on the intellectual narratives that must at some point govern the policy and govern the basis of governance. To begin with, this also shows that unless we have the courage to have an open mind, we will not be able to deal with the problems that are going to define this era. All discussions, all debate, all ideas basically seek to fashion a road towards the future. And we are at that cusp of history when we have to find precisely what will make us a foremost intellectual as well as a national power of the 21st century. So I welcome this debate as part of that major national effort. Essentially, what we are discussing today is narratives and doctrines of power and polity. Broadly, anything you say, there will always be an exception. But history offers us broad truths by which we can map both the past, examine where we are in the present, and see if you can find a rational way towards the future. Broadly, the sanction for power can be divided into two phases. One was the metaphysical sanction, as distinct from what I will call particularly after the 18th century, the physical sanction. The metaphysical sanction was essentially symbolized by a ceremony called the anointment through the priest. And this anointment linked up power with, was the link between power and religion. So kingships, the authority and legitimacy of kingships did not lie and did not vest in the subject. They vested in God, they vested in the divine, they vested in sometimes a fashioned creation of the divine. And this, in Western terminology, became known as the divine right of kings. But the divine right of kings was not limited to the West. Almost every single, broadly when we talk of history, we're talking about the last 2,500, 3,000 years in which narrative history has a certain continuity and a certain basis in textual corroboration. So if you see the great communities, the great spaces in which religion anointed kingdom, one was the Judaic Abrahamic space, which was Judaism, Christianity, and then Islam. The other was the Indian space, which was essentially Hindu, Buddhist. And then there was the Confucian space, Confucian Japanese space. These are broad spaces. In each one, the emperor, even up till now, the Japanese emperor is the son of God. Islam, which is very clear about Tawheed, that there should be, that the unity of God is essentially indivisible. Even Islam began, the kings began to accept through the Khalifat the Zill-e-Ilahi concept, the shadow of God. And of course, in the Old Testament, the the priest, the high priest, was the ruler, the Solomon David. In that sense, Jesus was a revolutionary, because Jesus was the one prophet who abandoned temporal power. But Christianity is less Jesus and more the church. And the church actually filled in this gap which Jesus had, in a sense, voluntarily or involuntarily created by abandoning this world for the next. The what I call the metaphysical sanction was basically a barter, a game of barter with the soul. The promise that you accept what you get in this life, because in return you're going to get an afterlife in which there is a heaven, a swarg, or a jannah, or whatever. It was, in my personal view, not public view, a bit of a con game by the ruling elites. But the fact is, it lasted a long while. It lasted a huge while, where a certain section of the elites simply arranged power between themselves, sometimes replaced one another, or quite often replaced one another, but never actually handed over power to the people. In recorded history, this system as we know it lasted at least 2,000 years. But the challenge had to come. And the challenge came from the rise of the physical, or the rise of the brain as the more important element in the alleged conflict between brain and soul. And this was the age of reason. The age of reason could only emerge out of two things. The significant dates were, first, the Chinese invention of paper, which began the possibility of mass communication and conversion of knowledge and expanded knowledge to a larger base. But paper only took knowledge from a handful of people to an elite. What changed the dynamics of knowledge and communication was the printing press. The moment the printing press came in 1453, immediately you could see the democratization of knowledge. Inevitably, the democratization process first began through the Bible and through the holy books. The demand for an understanding of your own texts came. But this demand for knowledge of your own faith actually led to the Reformation and led to the challenge to those faiths. As I was saying just a little while ago, once Gettysburg had come, once the printing press had come, Martin Luther was inevitable. And once Martin Luther ended the sanctity of religion as the basis for life itself, it was a massive rebellion. Once that happened, you could not then stop the rise of the Age of Reason. And from the Age of Reason, the democratization of knowledge into the creation of a middle class, the middle class becoming then the leaders of further change, and that further change then giving us, to more or less a degree, in different societies, in different ways, basically three doctrines or four doctrines that impacted these all doctrines that were created in the 19th century. These were doctrines that were shaped in the 20th century. And these are doctrines now that I can see which are facing collapse in the 21st century, leading to a vacuum which we do not know how to fill. What are these doctrines? The first was the doctrine of capitalism, Adam Smith. Basically, the management of mercantile relationships, the management of business relationships, and the transfer of power from the feudal elite into a new class, which is the business class, which is the class which created money as a tender. Previously, the basic wealth was land. Adam Smith turned land, the wealth, the definition of wealth, from land into money. And money, through trading, gave in turn the rise of colonialism. Colonialism was a consequence of trade, an inevitable consequence of trade. A second doctrine began to appeal for the first time, to the dispossessed. That was the doctrine of communism. The root of communism lay in the perception, and very valid perception, that power cannot completely be in the hands of an elite. And the challenge to this elite was again a revolutionary theoretical work done by Karl Marx and Engels. The 20th century was shaped by these two broad theories that became operational, but both theories had consequences in which lay the seeds of their own destruction. Capitalism led to excesses which could not be sustained. Communism led to a different kind of set of excesses which also could not be sustained. If in one case we saw the rise of a mercantile class, the rise of a business class, which operated under the rubric of freedom, which used or misused freedom in order to further its own interests. And the challenge of communism, where it laid its own self-destruction, was in the conversion of the state into the new god. The absence of freedom became the problem of communism. The excess or the exploitation of freedom became the problem of capitalism. A third consequence, colonialism as an idea could not be sustained because basically it was inhuman. Everywhere, suppression, racism, or its offshoots, fascism, they cannot be sustained because they can only work in societies in which the human being has become caged and imprisoned. But once you have let the ideas flow, the human beings, you have liberated the human beings from, let us say, the excesses of their brethren, then it's no longer possible. Fascism had the briefest of the three lives because it was also the most cruel and it was also the most inhuman. What emerged in its place, particularly in the post-colonial world, was the rise of nationalism. And the rise of nationalism was one of the most exciting evolutions in human history. We take nation states for granted, quite forgetting that till 1947, empires were taken for granted. So this is a very recent and very modern phenomenon. You can take it back to the treaties of Europe in the 16th century. But that is stretching a point. The real nation, the Second World War de-recognized nations. Power was superior to national rights. Nobody actually argued with that concept. The wars that took place were between those who wanted to expand their power, not those who wanted to surrender power to new entities. The largest growth of the British Empire took place after World War I, when its territory increased by almost 50% or 60%. So World War I was not fought for the liberation of you and I. There's a very famous story which I always insist on repeating. Those of you who are from Calcutta will know about Lord Sinha. He was a law member of the Viceroy's Council when Gandhiji started his independence movement. And his independence movement had his mass movement had its origins in Champaran. Next year, by the way, is 100 years of Champaran, and I hope all of you will remember that. But his national movement begins in 1919 after Jallianwala. Jallianwala, Rowlatt, and non-cooperation movement, Khilafat movement. When Gandhiji started it, Lord Sinha very famously said, I don't know what this man in a dhoti is trying to do. The British Empire will last for 400 years. It did not last for even 40 years after that. Less than 40. It lasted for not even 25 years after that. Showing what the power of mass upsurge, of mass mobilization could do. One of the most significant facts of history, which once again we tend to forget, is that the most basic polity that has governed human beings since known history, is kingdoms and empires. You can't think of any other alternative model. For the first time in the 20th century, every empire in the world collapsed. It's not just the British Empire, every empire in the world collapsed. You can start with the great empires. The Chinese Empire collapsed. Japan had a brief empire, so it's really a 20th century. The Chinese Empire collapsed. The Mughal Empire collapsed. The Ottoman Empire collapsed. The Habsburg Empire collapsed. The Tsarist Russian Empire collapsed. The Spanish Empire collapsed. The Portuguese Empire collapsed. You can go on and on. Every single empire in history collapsed in this phase, leading to the emergence of the nation state. And the emergence of the nation state was propelled sharply by two revolutions, the French Revolution and the American Revolution. But while we say this, we must never forget that in many other societies, they may not have been anything as dramatic as the French Revolution or the American Revolution, but they were great intellectual revolutions. They were great intellectual revolutions because the question that was there through the 20th century as empires began to collapse is a question that has still not been fully answered. Is that you may get the nation, but what will you do with the nation? What will be the content of nationalism? Patriotism is very good. Without patriotism, we are no one, all of us. Patriotism is the one thing that eliminates color, language. But once you have patriotism, what shall be the content of that nation state? And this, the intellectual revolution that took place, one of the great intellectual revolutionaries of his time, of his age, was clearly Swami Vivekananda. And then he introduced ideas that I tell you, if you read him properly and think about it, even you might not find it possible to digest it. Sometimes it's easy to venerate a person without listening to him, because it is dangerous to listen to him. It is much easier to worship him, because it's safe. Huh? Here is a man who in the last decade of the 19th century says, first bread, then religion. Even if you read nothing else, forget anything else. Forget all his lectures, all his work, all his... And then what have we done with religion? Have we sent religion into the kitchen sink? Has now religion, the balm of the soul, become nothing more than eating habits? Is that your total philosophy? Do we have the courage to answer that question? Do we have the courage to place to honor his sense of priorities? First, bread. And therefore, the New Age basically, in my view, is defined by the equality of bread. And unless nationalism promises the equality of bread, it becomes a hollow nationalism. And therefore, that takes us to where? That takes us that the nation, freedom from the British, is incomplete. Freedom from the British is only a quarter of the battle. The real freedom is freedom from hunger. The real freedom is freedom from prejudice. The real freedom is freedom from regression. The real freedom is freedom from our own inner demons, which all of us possess. In the vacuum that was created, it was very easy for new and false prophets to come and equate religion with nationalism. It was very easy. The most extreme examples of that were in the Muslim countries, where Islam was turned into the basis of nationhood. Islam, like all faiths, is a brotherhood. It is not a nationhood. A faith is across nations. India and Nepal may have the same majority faith, or the same faith, or most Indians and most Nepalis will have the same faith. That doesn't make them the same nation. There are Hindus in Sri Lanka, there are Hindus, they were, certainly, I don't know how many are there now, or they are certainly now, in Malaysia. There are Hindus in Indonesia. They are Indonesians. There are Muslims all over the world. They belong to their nations. In the political sphere, they bow their head before their national flag. In their personal sphere, they may bow their head to Allah, or bow their head to Shiva, or bow their head to whoever they want to. That is their freedom. That is part of their personal faith. But this conversion of Islam into the basis of political movement is one of the most, its consequences are being visible in Pakistan. We don't have to look further. I mean, the other day at some discussion, not inside governance, but outside somewhere, and I pointed out, I said that the ISIS that you see is not the first Islamic state. The first state may have been a softer version, may have been a different version, but the first nation that to declare itself an Islamic state was Pakistan. This is not to demonize anyone. This is not to say that every Pakistani is evil or anything of that sort. This is to point out certain basic historical facts and see the consequences of those facts. We are here at what would be, you know, one of the most attractive aspects of your discussions, which is there in the subject and in the theme that you have, is space. Space. You have actually used the most important word in any dialectic. The most important word in any, the space. Let us find space to understand the other. And then, through a common effort, find the best solutions. Or find the best solutions for the way forward. And therefore, in my view, India achieved two major, when histories of the 20th and 21st century is written by somebody who has not, unlike Anirban and Amit, been trained in Oxford and Cambridge. When history is written from a slightly different perspective, India will stand out as being the major contribution of the two greatest achievements of the modern world. And I call, in fact, qualify that in the post-colonial world. And never forget that the post-colonial world is much, much bigger than the colonial world. One, 1947 marks the end of the greatest political force in history, which is European colonialism. After 1947, the age of colonialism was over. There's a very interesting anecdote, which I hope will help you understand. The British Empire was not run by people who were fools. They were pretty wise people, pretty intelligent people. And therefore, what did they do? Whenever a great general was defeated, they did something very sensible. They promoted him. Because all defeats are collective. So, when the person who we know as Duke of Cornwallis, you know, his past was pretty shocking. You would have thought that he would have been demoted and sent into basically wilderness. But he was the man defeated by George Washington. And given that George Washington didn't have any trained armies, and he had redcoats, the finest armies actually in that age, it was not a very happy, you know, CV to carry to the king. But King George III, who was also known as George the Mad, occasionally said very intelligent things. When Cornwallis went up to him, he said, "Oh, don't worry about those colonies. Who cares about them? They don't even have the money to pay for tea and tax. I mean, what use are they to it? Go to India. The true world war is taking place in India, and it is between us and the French. And whoever wins India will do the greatest contribution to my crown, because he who rules India will rule the world." And lo and behold, Cornwallis did that. It was under him, actually, that the gains of Hastings and so on were consolidated. Among other things, the permanent, the Bengal Land Settlement Act. Permanent settlement. Equally, when India was lost, the empire was lost. How do you think the British conquered Egypt? £8 million on loan, I'm quite sure they haven't given it back, was sent by India to finance the Egyptian army. How do you think Britain conquered China in the Opium Wars? Not troops from Yorkshire, it is from Calcutta. What did the British do when they officially banned slavery in their plantations? Banned slavery in 1833. They just transferred slavery to India. It is called indentured labor. My grandfather, who became an orphan in the famine in Bihar, he was lucky that destiny took him to a jute mill in Calcutta, where he was almost dead before, you know, he survived and then built another life. He could easily have been on one of the ships. Going to Fiji, instead of talking to you, I would have been the source of great adulation as a West Indian cricketer. Viv Richards and I are exactly the same age. So they just replaced. It was India that provided the human resources, India that provided the wealth, India that provided the armies. When India became free, empires collapsed. They could no longer prevent the upsurge. But we did something even more dramatic in 1950. In 1950, we offered the template for what a modern nation state must be. And that template was inscribed in the Indian Constitution, the holy book of everyone in public life. And what is this Indian Constitution? It is based on five basic principles. Number one, liberty. Today, or 3 years ago, or 5 years ago, I'm saying the same thing because it does not matter. I have the rights of liberty and free speech. Number two, democracy. Liberty for the individual, democracy for the collective. Number three, faith equality as a principle instead of faith supremacy. That is basic to human rights. The great battles that are taking place to the west of us, in the space to the west of us, you know the names of the countries, are all being done in the name of faith supremacy. That one faith is supreme and will not permit coexistence. On the other hand, our faith equality, in fact, did not begin in 47. Our faith equality has existed as long as India has existed. Our faith equality precedes long before Islam. Our faith equality includes Buddhism, Jainism, various belief systems within the philosophy of this country. There is at no point, despite conflicts, of course there were conflicts. There were conflicts between Hindus and Buddhists. There were conflicts between Jains, and the regional human conflicts will never go away, but as a operating principle of life. You must remember, India never had internal borders. It may have had 700 kingdoms, it never had internal borders.
And India never, ever, the great letter written by Shivaji to Aurangzeb, says basically that, he reminds Aurangzeb, he says, what does your religion say? What is the opening line? He says, the Quran describes God as Rabbul Alameen, that is God of all the people, not God of only one Muslim. He said, why have you forgotten something that your father, grandfather, and great-grandfather said? In no kingdom in India, not in Shivaji, not in this thing, ever there was, aberrations apart, and I named one aberration. Aberrations apart, there was never a time when anyone interfered with anyone else's right to practice the faith. It is fundamental to our understanding. But after that, gender equality. You can see all over so many parts of the world there's gender equation. If we promise equality as a basic right of our constitution, how can we keep women unequal? In fact, those who use religious doctrine in order to promote gender bias or gender oppression do great harm. It's no longer feasible. It's simply not feasible anymore in the modern world. You will have to have reform. And finally, economic equity. There's nothing called economic equality. It has never happened, and it is unlikely to happen. But there is something called economic equity. And economic equity means what? It means basically that the poorest of the poor must have the first rights on economic growth, because they are the ones who need it most. I will happily repeat something I said in Parliament last year during the Ambedkar debate, that you can look at statistics in two ways. There were no accurate estimations, but it is roughly estimated that people living below the poverty line in 1947-1950 were about 65% surplus. Today, we proudly say, or some of us are very proud of the fact that it has gone down to 30%, to 32%. And say, look at where we are, look at where we are today. Except if you belong to that 30%, then that 30% which is below the poverty line is asking us, if it took you 70 years to come from 70 to 35, is it going to take you another 70 years to come from 35 to zero? Let me tell you one thing about technology. Technology has changed the meaning of time. Meaning of time. That what you achieved in the last 70 years, we are required to achieve only in the next 10. Aspirations are rising at that pace. There will be no stability until you can solve this basic. And then there will be no stability unless you go back to the basic message of Vivekananda, which is, where is the bread? Where is the bread? And I don't want fudge for an answer. Hunger has no religion. Hunger has no caste. So, as we develop and as we wait, I'm very often reminded of a poet who hasn't done very much to be reminded of. But his name was Matthew Arnold. Middle of the 19th century. He was a poet who was occasionally brilliant and generally mediocre. But he said something absolutely startling. He said, one age is dead and the other hasn't been born. And sometimes I feel we are actually living. You see, remember one thing. The cycles of history don't move along the demands of one lifetime. When the history of one lifetime is written, it may not get more than a page. If that. The cycles of history take their own time. But we are in that cusp where one age is dead and the other is waiting to be. The intellect will have to contribute to rebirth. Without intellect, there can be no renaissance. But all intellect, all capability, all talent must now go towards the creation of equity as the basis of all civilization. Inequity, prejudice, that age is dead. That cannot be revived. All human beings are equal, and therefore I tell you, I truly believe from my heart that it is one of the great blessings of our existence in this age is that I was born in India. Philosophy is deeply germane to both our individual as to our world. I cannot think of any other land. Yes, we have aberrations. Those aberrations have been created by human beings. But within, as we look towards our own philosophy, as we look towards our cultural inheritance, as we look towards the sagacity of the past and the opportunities of the future, you find that despite the variables, despite the problems, there has been no better time in history to be an Indian than this. Thank you.